summit comes 15 years after the ETAN report, and in the year when 50% of cabinet ministers in Canada are women. This was announced yesterday. I think that's really great. And it's 5 years after the first GenSet workshop here in Berlin, a project which was started by Elisabeth Politzer, and Elisabeth is still the driving force behind all the gender summits. And it's thank you. It's thanks to her effort that we have this unique combination of people from science and policymakers coming together to improve the impact of science and research through greater equality. And I invite you to show again your appreciation to her work. Thank you, Elisabeth. And now it's my real pleasure to introduce to you State Secretary at the Federal Ministry of Education and Research, Cornelia Quennet-Thielen. She has introduced and overseen a number of initiatives to promote gender equality in research, including the Professorinnen Program, the Excellenz Initiative, and the Pact for Forschung and Innovation. She is here today to open the conference and to talk about new initiatives and programs which we have in Germany, I hope, quite soon. Please give her a warm welcome. And then the floor is yours.
Professor Schraudner, ladies and gentlemen. 5 years ago, the GenSet consensus report considered that the question of how European science can benefit from integrated action on gender. Since then, this topic has been taken up repeatedly at European and national level by the Commission, the Competitiveness Council, and the Member States. All of them demand measures to ensure more gender equity in science. And one of the five priorities for the realization of the European research area is gender mainstreaming, in research in particular. Furthermore, gender equality has also been included for the first time as a strategy in our framework program Horizon 2020. And last year's Gender Summit Europe already paid tribute to this achievement. It was a difficult negotiation. Gender equality comprises, on the one hand, the integration of the gender dimension in research and innovation, and, on the other hand, the equal, structurally guaranteed participation of women and men at all levels of the science system. This is precisely what the 2010 GenSet consensus report called for. The fact that this two-pronged approach is prevailing is clearly a sign of progress. Now we must do everything in our power to improve measures to implement the justified demands and good strategies in the years to come. After all, we only need to take a look at the scientific careers of women to see that the so-called leaky pipeline is still dripping. I'm delighted that you all have come here to Berlin to the 7th Gender Summit so that together we can add momentum to this process. I would also like to take the opportunity to wish you a warm welcome on behalf of our Federal Minister of Education and Research, Johanna Vanka. Well, let us consider the question of how European science can benefit from integrated action on gender in a broader context and ask, how can society in Europe benefit from this action? Good answers do not grow on trees. Among other things, the current flow of refugees means that we will once again be faced with fundamental questions regarding gender equality. How can we ensure respect for our system of values and our constitutions, which safeguard the equality of men and women? How can we succeed in communicating our culture to people who have a different concept of the state and role of women in society? Well, this example shows we keep facing new challenges in our efforts to ensure equality. Let me take a closer look now at women in science. The basis for a high proportion of women in science is, of course, gender equality in schools. The new UNESCO report, Education for All, released only a few days ago, states that 62 out of 145 states guarantee equality for boys and girls in primary and secondary schools, which means that 83 states do not. In Europe, gender equality in school is not the problem, fortunately. And as far as science is concerned, one good piece of news is that the proportion of women taking PhDs is continuing to rise. On a European average, women now account for 47% of people completing doctoral studies in EU states. In other words, we have nearly achieved gender equity parity in this area. However, women only make up a third of researchers in all disciplines across the EU. This means that we are just above the global average of 30%. The benefit could indeed be greater for women, for science, and for society as a whole. Recruiting and retaining female researchers is one thing. The other thing is to ensure that this is indeed a matter of course for them to advance to top positions. It is good to see that there was an increase in the number of women in leading positions in institutions of higher education in 15 of 20 member states studied between 2010 and 2014. So what is the situation in my country, here in Germany? All in all, the proportion of women in leading positions is rising. Nevertheless, as of this summer, women only accounted for 8.3% of the board members of Germany's largest companies. The figure for all companies listed in the stock exchange was only 5.4%, even lower than last year. This is a grim state of affairs. The situation in the academic world is somewhat better. There were 54 female rectors or presidents of German institutions of higher education in 2013. This represents at least a share of 14.5%. So although this figure is higher than in the boardrooms, it is still far too low. I think we all agree on that. That shows that we still have a long way to go as far as professorships are concerned. The proportion of female grade A staff at institutions of higher education rose from 10% to over 17% between 2005 and 2013. This looks like whiskey. Not the right drink in the morning. let me come back. Well, yeah, the situation in the academic world. We still have a long way to go as far as the professorships are concerned. Female grade A staff 10 to 17% in the last 8 years, a positive development, but nevertheless, it means that men continue to account for more than 80% of our professors. As you know, in Germany, we do not only have universities, we also have the so-called non-university research institutions. Max Planck is the best known in the world. They also play a key role in our research system. And also there, we need to increase the share of women, particularly in leadership positions. I think we have, and I'm not only speaking about Germany, we have reached a decisive point in gender equality. There is a risk to merely content ourselves with the achievements that we have certainly made in the last years, but I think that would mean running the risk of squandering these attainments. So, what's the way forward? I see 6 key structural approaches for our policy in Germany, in Europe, and I think in many other countries in the world as well. First, legal regulations. This year, Germany has introduced a legal 30% quota for the boardrooms of large companies, following what were sometimes heated discussions. Many of you have followed. It wasn't easy. And I admit, I was not always a friend of quotas. But in the last decade, I too have clearly become an advocate of carefully crafted quotas. Why? Very simply, because otherwise there will be too little change. Experience has clearly shown that. And because, to be quite honest, I'm really tired of hearing the same old argument again and again, that quotas are not necessary because good work will always come out on top. We all know too many examples to the contrary. It is also important for me that the federal government, which is encouraging gender mainstreaming in so many areas, should itself set a good example for the equality of men and women. Another new law has been introduced for the equality of men and women with regard to introduce rules that all federal government seats on supervisory boards and other important bodies must be occupied by equal numbers of men and women by 2018. And I'm telling my own people in the ministries and the colleagues in the research system, 2018 is very, very soon. This will require considerable efforts to achieve this goal. And that shows the federal government is thus imposing higher standards on itself than on industry. I think this creates credibility. Second, voluntary commitments. Legal regulations alone are not enough to solve the problem. This is why, for many years now, we have strongly encouraged German research institutions to set themselves ambitious targets regarding gender mainstreaming. However, personal commitment, whether on my part or on the part of other women and of some men in research and politics, is only of limited effect without the support of clear obligations. Well, here in Germany, the Deutsche Forschungsgemeinschaft, our major research funding organization, which is also the largest in Europe, already introduced research-oriented gender equality standards in 2008. And these standards provide an important contribution to reform in higher education institutions that take gender equity into account. Nevertheless, there is still a lot to be done. The common goal of the gender equality standards is to significantly increase the proportion of women at all career levels in science, and the guiding principle there is the so-called cascade model. I think you all know it. It means that the goals for increasing the proportion of women at a specific qualification level are based on the proportion of women at the level directly below. And this copes with the argument that so many mentioned, there is not a large enough pool to find the women for certain levels in the system. The cascade model has also found its way into one of our three big pacts, as we call them, for the science system, into our Pact for Research and Innovation, a pact agreed between the federal government in Germany and our lender, the states in Germany, that guarantees our non-university science organizations planning security with regard to a steady increase in their funding over a period now already for many years. Not something we see in the rest of Europe, in very many countries. In return, the organizations commit themselves to goals, and one of these goals is to promote gender equality along the lines of the cascade model. Commitment is the one side. It normally only functions if you also monitor commitments. So all these organizations also have to report regularly on their achievements in this area. And both the federal government and the states together look at these reports every year. And this summer, when we had the latest version of the reports, we came to the conclusion that we really have to call again upon our organizations to strengthen their efforts, particularly regarding the quotas for young female researchers and female staff in leading positions. We are heading in the right direction, but to make more progress, we need to step up our efforts to ensure gender parity. And another area where to do this is reach gender parity on committees and official bodies. And we must design gender-neutral criteria for taking selection decisions. In my view, a great example here is the DFG's rule for calls to hand in a maximum of up to 10 publications. We know that long lists of publications is something that normally young male researchers can more easily achieve than young women that may have kids and family. My third approach is to offer incentives. These may be in the form of a competitive process. The best example here is, Martina Schraudner has already mentioned it, our program for female professors, the Professorinnen program. What we see is that an above average number of women leave the field of research upon completing their PhDs. But what we want to see is more female professors. To encourage this, the federal government and the lender launched this professorian program in 2008 with funds totaling 300 million euros. The program works at two levels. First of all, it increases the number of female professors. And secondly, it strengthens structural gender equality in institutions. because only those universities that present a convincing gender mainstreaming strategy are entitled to knock-on financing for up to 3 positions for female professors. And another important feature, the female candidates assert themselves against other male and female researchers in a normal appointment procedure judged on the basis of excellence. Only thus can they really become credible role models for female professors. We have 169 of our higher education institutions participating in the program. That is nearly half of them. And we were happy to appoint the 400th female professor this year. The basic idea of the program really works. It is to strengthen role models and change structures. Well, my fourth approach is to ensure good framework conditions. A lot of measures have been introduced in recent years. In Germany, too. We were somewhat later than other countries in this regard, but parents are now receiving more financial support. The infrastructure for childcare and early childhood learning is being improved. At the same time, we also must enhance the working conditions for young researchers, both male and female, so that they are able to better reconcile family and career. In Germany, clearly, the decision for tenure comes too late. The number, and a second feature, the number of professors has not kept up with the rapid increase of students that we have seen in the last 10 years. We are therefore currently negotiating a new program with our lender. I mention the lender so often because in our federal state in Germany, the big bulk of authority and over universities lies with our states, and therefore the federal government can only come in when we are able to agree with our lender on certain programs. What we want to achieve with this new program is to establish tenure-track professorships throughout the country. For Anglo-Saxon countries, this sounds a little surprising, perhaps, but in Germany at the moment, we have hardly any of this type of professorships here. The new programs would enable researchers to work independently at a relatively early age, and they would have a clear perspective of where they could go. So careers in research would become more transparent and more easy to plan. We know from our research that this is particularly important in the case of female researchers. Well, my fifth point is networking. Networks are important. You are networking over these 2 days. And you perhaps also had the opportunity yesterday to take part in the Ready for Dialogue conference on the gender dimension in science and research here in Berlin. My ministry was happy to support this networking event, both in financial terms and in other terms. And I think it was also a good opportunity to honor the 10th anniversary of the European Platform of Women Scientists. A happy birthday from me today as well. Yes, women's networks are good. They are very important. They have to grow. But I think we also need committed men in our networks. And therefore, I'm happy to see men in the audience today. And I really want to say, in particular towards the gentlemen present, that we can only achieve our goals by working together. My last point is research. My ministry is not only supporting structures for equal opportunities, but also many research projects dealing with gender topics in diverse areas. We are acting from conviction. And I'm seeing time and time again how concrete projects can provide even gender research skeptics, and we know well there are still plenty of them around, with good food for thought. This, for example, is the case with gender-sensitive health research. In the meantime, it is common knowledge that there are differences between men and women as far as the frequency and cause of diseases are concerned. We know men and women react differently to drugs or therapies. Women have a significantly higher risk of suffering from the undesirable side effects of drugs than men. Research must help to overcome this imbalance. Another field is technical developments. Londa Schiebinger of Stanford has rightly become famous for her gendered innovations project. Many of you know the example of the crash test dummies, which always used to be modeled on the body of an average-sized man. Cars have become safer since the introduction of crash test dummies, which take the body size of women and pregnant women into account. So this gender-sensitive research has closed a safety gap which went unheeded for a long time. A further important field is and remains inequality research. The Equal Pay Day 2016 campaign was launched the day before yesterday. It was researchers who studied the pay gap. In Germany, it still amounts to 22%, an unacceptable situation in my view. Last but not least, I would like to mention research into the effect of role ascriptions. Very important area if we want to see change happening. A project, for example, conducted by Professors Isabel Welpe and Claudia Peus of the Technical University of Munich, I hope they are here, I haven't seen them yet, and that was funded by us, is able to demonstrate that male role models prevail when selecting and assessing leaders in science and industry. The project is developing concrete recommendations to remedy this situation, and I really propose to everyone who is involved in selection procedures to look at these recommendations. I have done it myself, and they are really great and show how subtle certain effects work. All these examples show that gender research is making an important contribution to ensuring greater gender equality and to unleashing potential from which everyone can benefit. What is more, we can only succeed by involving the natural and social sciences and the humanities to an equal extent, a strategy that we follow not only with regard to gender research, but in our research portfolio in general. I would like to invite those of you who wish to find out more about the research that we are funding to an event that will happen by the end of this month on the 25th and 26th of November here in this forum, when researchers from various disciplines will be reporting on their work under the motto of living cultural change, promoting diversity, strengthening equal opportunities. It is one of the projects that we fund in our program, Women to the Top. Let me conclude. We have been able to overcome many obstacles on the way to equal opportunities for men and women. But there are still a lot of walls to be brought down. I would like to thank everyone who is committed to the goal of gender equality, and certainly my special thanks also go to those who have organized and prepared this year's Gender Summit Europe. The addition of a Gender Summit Africa and a Gender Summit Asia-Pacific emphasizes the global relevance of the questions we talk about, and it also underlines the success of the gender summits. Let us work together to ensure that success continues to grow. I'm sure you will have very interesting 2 days, I hope, with a lot of new ideas, with a lot of networking, with a lot of new findings that can bring our common cause forward. Willkommen in Deutschland and have a great conference. Thank you.
Thank you very much, State Secretary, for these warm welcome words and the encouragement to all work together to bring together gender equality in science innovation. Before we really start, I just wanted to say a few housekeeping words so that you know what's happening, where you are, and how you find your way around the Gender Summit. If you could launch the presentation, please. So you know you're in Berlin, you're in the heart of Berlin, which I think is wonderful. It's the first Gender Summit Europe that is not happening in Brussels, but in Germany. There is a lot to see around here. So once you're done with the networking, please enjoy the wonderful area that you're in, the rich history of this city, and maybe a little bit of shopping if there's time for that as well. We're also in a very nice but rather complex venue, so I just wanted to give you an overview. You have a map of this in your folder as well, but just that you've seen it once. We're currently on level one in the plenary. Here you will also have two of the parallel session and the knowledge exchange fora, which are in the atrium. And of course, the exhibition and the breaks are here as well. On level three and level four, there are the other breakout rooms for the parallel sessions. And again, you find the rooms, numbers, and descriptions in your program, but also in the app. If you have any problem finding your way around, please contact one of the ladies in the yellow scarves, orange scarves. They will be very happy to show you around. So who's here? As every year, we have an amazing number of delegates from all over the world. So it is the Gender Summit Europe, but the people in this room represent way more than just Europe. We have people from Australia, from the US, from Korea, from Japan. And it's really wonderful to take this opportunity and get to know each other for 2 days. So please don't just look at the wonderful speakers that we have on stage, but also at the people sitting next to you, because I think we have an incredible amount of knowledge in this room. Of course, this Gender Summit wouldn't at all be possible without the generous support and contributions from our main partners and supporters. Our partners are the ones who really made it possible for us to be in this room, who paid a lot of the bills that we could otherwise not afford. But we also have a lot of supporting organizations who are supporting speakers to be here, supporting individual delegates, support us with their networking. So I would just like to say a very big thank you to them for making this possible. I mentioned before that we're trying to really harness the huge potential of the people in this room, and every year we're trying to make the summit more and more interactive. So please make this your summit and have a chance to really contribute to the program and to the discussion. There are several ways that we're trying to encourage that through questions. After each panel, you will have a chance to ask questions to the speakers. Of course, there's never enough time to questions, so please also use social media, Twitter, to ask questions, and we will make sure that the speakers will get these questions and whenever possible that these questions are answered. We encourage you not to just ask questions, but also comment on things, either with a tweet where you might have a link you want to share or with an image you want to share. And just to show how important this is to us, we decided that the best contribution under 140 characters, so the best tweet, and the best image will win a free free participation in the Gender Summit Europe 2016. So please, if you want to get your mobile phone out, we won't be offended. We'll actually be delighted to have you contribute on social media and really make the room buzzing with your experience and your input. There's also a chance for you to vote. There's two ways of voting. The first one is maybe a bit more traditional. We want to leave it up to you to select the best posters. We have some very experienced researchers, but also some young scientists who present their work, not in the panels and the plenaries, but in the posters which you see outside. You will be given a sticker and asked to put it next to the name of the poster that you think is best. And again, the best poster will win a free participation in the next summit. So please vote and let us know which one you like best. We're also trying to do some live voting on stage, and we're going to do this in a minute. It's a huge experiment. Sometimes it works great, sometimes it doesn't work that well, as a way to really gather the information in this room, get your opinion, and also use it for the debate that would follow this summit, to see what actually do people in this room think about the issues we're discussing. It's called Kahoot. It's game-based, and we're going to try it in a moment. Let's see how that goes. There's a speed networking session and a tweet up. We did speed networking before. It's actually a great way to get to know the people. It's happening in every break in the speed networking cafe at the end of the room. So please join us for one of that. And again, you can win something. I mentioned the Kahoot, the way that you can do that. Easiest is with our mobile app. I see people are already scanning the QR code. You can do that or just go to this link. And it gives you a chance to create your own program, to contact some of the speakers, to contact other delegates. So please make use of that as well. With that, because I don't want to take too much of your time, I would like to test this Kahoot with you. So if we could go onto the website. So if you have the app, if you just please press vote, we can launch it, I think. And if you don't have the app, please go to kahoot.it and enter the game PIN. So it's kahoot.it, or press vote on your phone, and then you're asked to enter a nickname. Which will, somebody is already there. Sanne is on. Oh, here we're coming. Hello, Heidi. And Viv. Yes. The Wi-Fi username is gender, and the password is 2809B. The username is Jen. Oh, you have to enter the PIN, which is there, the 158265. So this is just a test case to warm you up. We're going to do it after the plenaries, but I can see people are getting in there. We have 30 players. 31. I think we're going to start at 40, so... and we're there. Jen is number 40. So if we could just go on start now, please. Okay, we have three questions for you, so please get ready. our first question is, who is in this room? Which group do you most associate with? Would you consider yourself a scientist, a policymaker, a gender scholar, or belonging to another group? And you have different colored icons on your screen now, and you press the one which corresponds with, what's here, 22 answers. We have 10 seconds left for the voting. Seven. Excellent. So it seems like we didn't quite get our criteria, our groups right. Most people consider themselves in the group other stakeholder. Some people are scientists, some gender scholars, interestingly, is not the most represented group in this room, which I think is actually fantastic news. So we're not preaching to the people who are already convinced of what we do. Let's go to the next question, please. How many gender summits have you attended so far? And please count this one as well. So one would be the minimum number that you can give. I can see people are warming up. It's going much faster now. It's going to be interesting because I think we have a very loyal community of people who are coming. Let's see the results. So for most people, it's the first gender summit. So this is very nice. Welcome. I think it's good that we're in Berlin this time. We're attracting new people. Let's go to the next question, the last warm-up question. This is a bit of a tough one. When do you think will the mission that we are all here to talk about be achieved? We didn't dare to put in this year or 2015. We thought that would be a bit too much. In 5 years, 5 to 10 years, more than 10 years, or never. Oh, not too bad. More than 10 years. Only 6 people are pessimistic enough to say never. Hopefully, by the end of this summit, we will convince them to change their opinion and go for more than 10 years or even less. So this is really it for the warm-up and for the introduction. Thank you all so very much for coming. I would like now to hand over to Curt Rice and the first panel, and I hope you have a wonderful time here at the Gender Summit. Thank you.
Good morning. Could I ask the 3 speakers for this session to find a comfortable place on stage while I'm making a few introductory comments? My name is Curt Rice. I am the head of Norway's Committee on Gender Balance and Diversity in Research, which is a committee organized by the Ministry for Higher Education and Research in Norway, and we have a mission to both advise our government and the institutions in our sector about issues related to gender equality and diversity. And I look forward to telling you a little bit more about that at a reception that we're hosting later this afternoon here at the Gender Summit, which I hope you'll also be able to attend, a session which we are hosting in collaboration with our Swedish colleagues. And you'll learn more about their program also this afternoon. I've just recently moved to Oslo myself, which I think of as the Deep South, having spent the last quarter of a century in Tromsø. And I'm having the opportunity to work on a number of policy issues in my new job as rector of the University College of Applied Sciences in Oslo and Akershus. And I want to tell you just one thought about that kind of work before we get started. I think that one of the most important books for me in recent years that affects the topic of this summit is Daniel Kahneman's book, Thinking Fast and Slow. One of the core messages of that book is that there is bias everywhere. Experience and context affect every decision that we make. We simply are not up to the task of making objective evaluations. Now, many of you who attend the Gender Summit are, of course, familiar with the concept of implicit bias, and I won't review that here. It's a term that's broad enough to cover actually many types of bias that Kahneman discusses. Here, we're usually talking about bias against women in various kinds of contexts. The context that affects us career-wise is the assessment of quality. There are biases that affect the way we exercise evaluations of quality. In fact, there are biases that affect our very conception of quality. And this presents an enormous management challenge for any activities that are based on quality. Just think about giving grades to the work of students, how easy it is to disagree about what kind of grade a student should give. That in itself is an exercise that reveals the challenges associated with objectivity and quality. These kinds of issues about bias, about quality, about gender equality, and the measurement of quality are brought together in this session this morning. And lucky for me, these are two of my core interests, actually. And they're united for me in the sense, metrics and gender equality are united in the sense that on the one hand, they're related to situations where assessment is necessary and difficult, and they are situations in which bias is revealed. The acknowledgement of bias should affect policy. And the question is, how? Metrics get used everywhere in academia, when we hire people, when we promote people, when we award grants, when we award tenure, and the list is long. Sometimes we're so hung up on trying to find the best metrics for measuring quality that they recently go overboard. An example of that is a proposal recently advanced by the Norwegian government to evaluate the publication activities of researchers. I can't possibly go into the details because I can't actually figure them all out, but it is almost a sweet attempt to reward publishers for their publishing activity. The bibliometricians behind it had recently noticed that co-authorship was more common in the natural sciences and medicine and less common in the humanities and social sciences. And those researchers in fields with co-authors felt punished. So a proposal has been made by the government to use a very elaborate algorithm which technically rewards co-authorship. And it's interesting to look at the details, which I'm not going to do, but I would like to point out one very important thing, namely that this work is done totally devoid of a consideration of whether or not this policy change has any gender effects. Is there a gender perspective in the policy? The intention of the policy is to increase the visibility of work done in the natural sciences and medicine and to decrease the visibility of work in the humanities and social sciences. That in and of itself, when we know the distribution of men and women in those fields, will inevitably have an impact on men and women that is different. It will have the effect of making the production of women less visible relative to the production of men. Or so one could speculate, and then we get into the second problem about trying to measure quality and using metrics to do that, because metrics will always be gamed. So given the introduction of a system which rewards co-authorship, I here make a prediction that co-authorship in Norway is about to explode. Maybe even in the humanities, co-authorship will explode. It's a policy that is, in its implementation, blind to the effects of bias. It asserts a firm belief in the possibility of being able to count our way to quality and a belief in meritocracy. And that's our topic this morning. We as scientists believe that we know quality when we see it, and we believe that it can be measured. There are many different kinds of metrics. Our evaluation of these metrics must be sure to ask about gender equality issues and diversity issues. And that's what we're going to do in the next hour and a half. So we have three speakers this morning who will touch on these topics in various ways, and they'll be making presentations of about 20 minutes. I would like to take 5 minutes after each presentation, directly after each presentation, for a couple of questions and comments, and that leaves us 15 minutes at the end of the session for more. I would like to ask you to read up on the long list of merits that each of our speakers have on the webpage or in the program book. And instead of spending time on that here, I will just wish the three of you welcome, and I'll invite Professor Martina Schraudner to come and make her presentation.
So, an assessment from a German practitioner is my part here. What about gender equality advancements in the German research landscape? And the state secretary described already the German research landscape. Perhaps a little bit in more detail, we have these four non-university research organizations. We have Max Planck for basic research, Fraunhofer for applied research, quite a lot of engineering inside. We have the Helmholtz Association. They are doing quite a lot in the field of medicine. And also the Leibniz Association. There is quite a lot of service organizations brought together, and a lot of economy and social sciences institutes doing their work there. In total, there are more than 100,000 scientists working in these organizations. And you see also the share of female researchers or the among them in these different organizations. On the other hand, we have the universities, more than 100, spread over whole Germany. The same procedure we have within this non-university research organizations, all of them are decentralized organizations, and more than 200 universities of applied sciences. So in total, more than 150,000 people working in science for their whole life, more or less. We have a variety of laws and also initiatives. The state secretary mentioned already when it was in the year 1956 when the basic law was passed, the equal rights for men and women. In 2006, the Act on Equal Treatment was passed to prevent or stop discrimination. And this year, we got this quota for the boardrooms. And on the other hand, we have quite a lot of initiatives. And for all, or for these two initiatives I mentioned here, our Chancellor Angela Merkel is a sponsor of these initiatives. And I would like to start with the Charta der Vielfalt. This is a network of companies who are committed to promote diversity in their companies. And in this year, Chefsache was started. For people who understand German, it's a wonderful name, because Chefsache is the meaning this. This is a task only the chef, the major person, has to do. And this describes that this is a network of CEOs, of leaders, who are personally committed to this goal to increase the amount of women in leading positions. And this again describes this top-down initiatives. And I really think this is really important. They have most impact. The European Commission funds quite a lot of initiatives which are much more bottom up. This is important too, but these top-down initiatives are important because they are normally connected with money. And this is always quite helpful, as we all know. So this already mentioned Pact for Research and Innovation, there the increase in the budget is connected with activities to increase the amount of women in science. Then we have, this is for the non-university research organizations. Then we have the Excellence Initiative. This is a funding program for the universities. And here we have gender equality as a criterion for the evaluators, for the international evaluators of this excellence programs written by the universities. And the third one is the Professorinnen program, which is so important because this program was a starting point to really increase the amount of female professors in the whole research landscape. And already mentioned, the DFG, the equality standards there, where gender equality was written there as a statement, gender equality affects quality of research. This was written already in the year 2008, and I think this was also a very strong statement given by this funding organization. But still, we need to explain why few women remain in research in science. And there are three hypotheses in place and quite often mentioned. The first one is the leaky pipeline. And quite often, it's said that it's enough to have more women filling this pipeline, and then more women will get into higher positions. The second one is the necessity of mobility. Most of the women are not mobile enough to get into high positions in academia. And the third one is that cultural aspects in science are responsible. The framework conditions and stereotypes exclude women from reaching top-level positions in academia. And I want to go through these arguments and hypotheses and try to find out which are important. So, leaky pipeline, it is not enough to simply fill the pipeline. There are several studies in the US, some humanities there really show a high proportion of female students, but women are still underrepresented in top level positions. This was published this year by Leslie et al. And a big survey among postdocs in the Max Planck Society, which was done this year, gave the result that especially in the section where most women scientists are working, in the humanities section, the largest gender differences can be observed in their answers. And I gave you here this, I give you here the three most important differences. Women more often report an overload through pressure, the lack of recognition of achievements and compatibility. 20% of the women see, with regard to equal opportunities and compatibility, disadvantages of their own gender. Men assess the overall situation significantly better than women. And this is not only true for Max Planck. I think this is an example. You would find similar results also in completely different settings. I can give you also data for that, but it's so clear here within this survey results. The hypothesis necessity of mobility. And these are results from younger persons at the end of the university time, and we asked men and women, and you only see a difference in the security requirements. Here you get a little bit more asking for security from the women, from the female respondents. And this is the result that at the beginning of their professional career, both women and men are very mobile and flexible. But, and this is this other picture, when they are more experienced, with the meaning these are people working since 5 years after university, something like this, this flexibility in mobility is decreasing, but for both, for men and women. So it seems to be depending from different stages of life that mobility of both women and men decrease. So it's not depending from the gender, but from their life stages, if they are mobile or not. And these are results which are given also from other authors in other studies. And once again, the necessity of mobility. There are different patterns of mobility existing. And this is a study done with AcademiaNet professors. AcademiaNet is a database where women can be nominated by research organizations, by grants or prize winners. They are all in here, and they are across all disciplines. Every kind of science, every kind of engineering, every kind of medicine fields are included here. It's a big database, and we got some results about this mobility patterns. This AcademiaNet women do not show uniform mobility behavior regarding geographical and institutional mobility. So there is no pattern. More or less 25% of AcademiaNet women never left the country where they did their PhD. I think this is important. These are selected women. The women are selected because they are really good, they are prize winners. And this is something very special for engineers, because normally engineers have a time period in industry and then come back to the academia. Only 6.6% of women in the academia network have worked in industry. And we also found that academia net women who have worked at research organizations show greater international and institutional mobility. So these are results from this more experienced, in that case, really more experienced women. And I want to give you some data for the third hypothesis too. And this, I think, is really a very interesting example. We call them exit candidates. Exit candidates because these are nine men, nine women, who left academia, but on this inner stage of group leaders, but these persons are really wonderful scientists. Quite a lot of them won awards. More or less all of them were seen already as professors or will become soon a professor, but they left not only the institution but also academia completely. And we found five major types of reasons why they did this. And I want to go through this. On the left side, we have this long-term warriors, people who really think about security and the chances to keep in science and to be sure to get a next position in science, and then they opt out. And that was their main reason to leave science. And here we have similar amounts, or in this time, women and men. The next group are people who started to work in science with a clear goal to leave science in direction of industry. And the next one really criticize the research culture. And here the amount of women is higher. Same also for this undervalued argument. People don't feel valued in a proper way, and that's the reason why they leave. And the last one, they get a good chance outside academia, and they take that chance. So, to summarize, more women criticize the working culture and the working climate, and there are four main aspects which are leading to frustration. It's the performance pressure, it's isolation, visibility, and a male-dominated culture. And for sure, these women are able to perform in a proper way. But quite often, and this is a finding from several surveys we did in several research organizations, from the beginning, already as students, they don't have the same chances. We found for a big research organization that especially engineering students, male and female, the women get the jobs in the administration and the men get the job in research. And then you have the next job as a bachelor or a master student, and then you don't be experienced in research, you're not done this measurement work, so you will get again the job closer to administration. When there is a conference to be organized, for sure the woman has to organize it, and she really has to organize because her professor is telling her, you have to do that. And this is again a year she can't do research. So this is a going on and going on, and it's really the working culture and the climate in research, which is not always clear and not always so exactly described by each person, but they can feel it. You feel it when you are working in this research. It's not the same to work as a man or a woman in this culture. So, coming together, I think the main reason why few women don't want to stay in science is really this cultural aspect in science. The framework conditions and stereotypes exclude women from reaching top-level positions in academia, and I think this is a point we really have to work on. This would be a next step to work on. And there are good news for further engagement. There are evidence-based results showing the necessity to promote women in science. And really a great work done by Lei Pan from Elsevier, and she will give the last talk of today, and I really recommend to listen to her work because the data are so important. In subject areas with more balanced gender distribution, women tend to focus on different topics. So different perspectives really bring different results. And for Germany, female-only publications are the most international collaborative. And mixed gender publications are more interdisciplinary but less internationally collaborative than monogender publications. So also more interdisciplinary research we can get when we have this perspective of women included in the science field. And then the work from Gretten, an equal gender representation can help to expose the innovation potential of teams, important too, and Woolley, Anita Woolley, who described that the presence of women in a group increases the problem-solving skills of the group as a whole. So that's really evidence-based results showing the necessity, but we still have to do quite a lot. And these are data from Germany again. Germany is ranked 5th for patents worldwide, but only 5% are from women at the moment, so a lot to do in that field. And Germany is ranked 4th for publications worldwide, but only 20% are from women authors. Again, a lot to do. So I think we will need some gender summits more, and I want to thank you for your attention.
So I think we should, it's fresh in our minds, if you didn't get your comment written on Twitter, I will open the floor for just a few minutes of comments, and I imagine there are somehow people with microphones magically appearing. I see some microphones and I see some hands, so if we could bring those together, magical things can happen.
Thank you very much. My name is Christel Baldisler, University of Luxembourg. I have two questions. The first is concerning the figures you show us of the Fraunhofer, Leibniz, and so on, to show us the employees, also die wissenschaftlichen Mitarbeiter, Mitarbeiterinnen, aber da nicht den, and they're not the quota of men and women. And the second question, perhaps more, for me, more important is, how you have measured the mobility, because we have the impression that female scientists have a more tendency or are easier to go for a while abroad and then coming back where they have the home, let's say. And that was my question, what you have measured when you measured the mobility, and sorry for not having read what you have done.
So for the mobility, this was really for AcademiaNet, when they left the institution, sorry? They go out. Yeah, they go out. They really go out. only when they really go out. And the first question was about the numbers. I gave the female employees, the percentage of female employees, and the scientific employees. So it's not 33% is not from the female employees, but from the total. Yes, that's it. Thank you.
Let's take one more back here. Can you raise your hand so she can see you? Yes, thank you.
Hello. I'm Tonya Blows from the Organization for Women in Science for the Developing World. And also regarding mobility, I just wanted to highlight that actually it is quite a different question, though, for women specifically from the developing world, where mobility is actually a crucial element for them. They don't have the resources, they don't have the equipment, they don't have the contacts. Without the possibility of going to another country to study, they may well never get their research done.
Yeah, that's for sure.
We discussed already yesterday, so. Okay.
Mm-hmm. Great, thanks once again, welcome. Martina. Mm-hmm.
And we will have some general time for questions at the end of the session also, so please write your question on Twitter or prepare it and keep it with you. And by the way, a little tip to those of you who are writing on Twitter, don't start your tweet with the @ sign. That cuts out the ability to follow. And before I introduce our next two speakers, I want to make another Twitter comment, which is that lately I've become completely addicted to a Twitter account called Man Who Has Everything. And the Man Who Has Everything account twists things that are often said about women into comments about men. For example, it says things like, well, I can accept having men on the boards of directors as long as they're chosen for their qualifications and not just their gender. So in the spirit of the Man Who Has Everything Twitter account, I should say that we're very pleased to have two male scientists with us later in this session, and maybe they'll even be able to comment on how they work to balance their obligations at home and at the office, so we can get some tips from them on that. Just kidding. There's so few of us that I have to use the chance to tease you a bit. Our next presentation is by Professor Stephen Curry from Imperial College in the United Kingdom. He'll be talking about the changing landscape for research metrics. Stephen.
How do I advance the slides? Good morning, and thank you very much to the organizers for the opportunity to present to you this morning. This is my first gender summit, and I'm very much an amateur in this space. And my title is The Changing Landscape of Research Metrics. It's not, as advertised in your program, addressing the question, does gender affect scientific productivity, which I read to my alarm this morning. So I fear I am going to be a disappointment to you. However, I think we can all agree that the world has changed an enormous amount through the power of technology in the last 20 years or so. The rise of computerization, of digitization, and as we see in this photograph from the opening ceremony of the London 2012 Olympics with Tim Berners-Lee, a small figure there in the center, we now have the World Wide Web, and we have many benefits that have accrued from those innovations. And now, increasingly, I think we have the ability to count and track many aspects of human activity and to enumerate them. And we certainly know in the UK that our government is counting and tracking many aspects of human activity, some of which I think are invading our private lives, but that's a matter for another day. And there's no doubt that the ability to capture that sort of information, quantitative information about many aspects of human activity, is enormously useful. In the private sector, if you're interested in manufacturing, then it's important to sort of keep track of your inventory, to have some clear idea about worker productivity and about how much money you are making year on year, and hopefully you're in a profit situation and not a loss. Similarly, in the public sector, if you're running hospitals, as in the NHS in the UK, then understanding bed occupancy and the success rates of particular operations, perhaps even the performance rates of individual doctors, are important numbers to be able to capture in order to improve the activity and to follow it and track it. But numbers have got a seductive objectivity that I think they don't always merit. And when you apply them to other areas of human activity, such as life in a university, then I think the application becomes more questionable, more contestable, and the source of a number of problems, one of which I think obviously impacts the gender issue. So the World University Rankings from the Times Higher is just one of about 10 different university rankings that claims to be able to measure university performance. So Caltech is currently number one, or it was last year, I think it still is this year, with a score of 94.9 somethings. Okay, so I can't quite get the Times Higher to tell me exactly what the something is, but it's a blend of reputation in research, it's a blend of your staff-student ratio when it comes to teaching, it's the number of papers that you publish in, it's to do with the impact factors of the journal. So you conflate all of these different numbers and you say, well, this is what counts for quality. And I think that's a mistake in order to apply those sorts of things. But we have got a world in which, you know, we count things obsessively, and we still do give an awful lot of veneration to numbers. And this rise of metrics is something that I think has caused a lot of concern in general throughout the academy, and I just sort of highlight here, these slides will be available afterwards, so if you're interested in reading some more, and I would recommend the writings of people like Ron Vale, Ellen Hazelcorn, Peter Lawrence in this area. I think it's become a general concern for many in the academy about how research and researchers are evaluated, and we want to try and make sure that we do the best job that we can of that. And so into that space then, in the UK in the past year, and I think this is one of the reasons why I'm speaking to you today, even though I still am an avowed amateur, I did participate in a year-long review of the use of metrics that was conducted in the UK. It was commissioned by the Minister for Universities and Science in England in 2014. And it was aimed to look in general at the sort of issue of metrics, but in particular at whether or not metrics had a role in helping to run what is known as the Research Excellence Framework, which is an exercise that occurs every 6 years or so in the United Kingdom, which judges university research performance and is used thereafter to disperse money. And so the universities take it extraordinarily seriously. It's a laborious exercise at the minute. It's largely done by peer review. But everybody complains about it, but everybody participates because there's money in it at the end of the day. And money is the most important metric of them all. So there was a panel convened from various parts of the academic sector, both funding agencies, learner societies, publishers, academics, and a couple of expert bibliometricians. And we had a fairly open process. So although we did have a remit to look at, you know, how metrics could be used in the future REF exercises, Research Excellence Framework exercises, we did want to look broadly at this. And we didn't want just to have a UK perspective. We drew upon sources of information because these are issues that have been discussed internationally, and particularly in Canada and in the EU. There are already existing documents that we drew on. We tried to be as open as we could. We invited evidence. We had meetings and working groups from around the country. We were transparent about the inputs and outputs. Everything was published on the internet as quickly as we received it. As part of the review, there was also an in-depth, up-to-date review of the bibliometrics literature, which was published. And so that's the brown document here. And there was also a quantitative correlation exercise to try and see, could the outcome of the previous REF have been predicted just using metrics? And that was also published as another fairly lengthy document. So it was a very robust exercise. You know, I would actually, although it's 170 pages long, I would commend it to you. There is an 8-page executive summary, which is at least worth 5 minutes of your time. And I just want to quickly go through some of the headline findings to see where we ended up. So the headlines are such: the description, production, and consumption of metrics remain contested and open to misunderstanding. I don't think there's any great argument about that. And as far as the REF goes, and as far as any exercise in research and researcher assessment goes, then peer review, despite its flaws and despite its capacity for bias, which is something that we did talk about to some degree, continues to command widespread respect. And you know, the academic community is only going to invest in a process in which it has some confidence. Metrics are here, they're here to stay, they do have their uses, but they really have to know their place, and so they have to support rather than supplant expert judgment. Inappropriate indicators, the impact factor is a well-known case of this, create perverse incentives, are often gamed, and may often lead to unintended consequences. And the sort of key message, and this sort of ties into the ideas about responsible research, is that metrics themselves need to be used responsibly. Ideally, we would like open data. We don't always have that at the moment. And they should always be used in a context-sensitive manner. So the particular recommendations, again, there's a total of 20 of these, but I'm just going to sort of pull out or condense them into four major themes. One is on language. Actually, the very word metric is something that we discussed quite a bit, which shows you, I think, how sort of finely we went into some of these sorts of issues. Metric implies a measurement. And if you're measuring something, it implies you know what the something is. But if you're measuring a quality of research or a quality of a researcher, then it's difficult to define. And this is one of the problems that the league tables run into, is that they're not really defining what they're measuring. And so we did actually even discuss whether we should stick to the word indicator, which I think is a slightly humbler term for the use of the numbers that we may be gathering, in which we then use to inform our judgments. We want to make sure that all the institutions and bodies that are using these sorts of informations do so in an open and transparent way and lay before their employees, for example, the principles on which they are going to make use of any kind of metric when they are doing performance assessment. So we want a clear statement of principles from these people, and ideally those principles would be worked out in consultation then with the people who are going to be assessed with the metrics so that they are engaged and have some ownership of the debate. Research managers, administrators, anyone involved in recruiting, promotion panels, and also researchers themselves, because researchers are not slow to sort of show off metrics, particularly if they are working in their favor, all need to be mindful of the limitations of any metrics or indicators that they're using. And data providers, and of course this is now becoming a big industry, not just for Times Higher, but for many other publishers and data providers, need to strive for greater transparency. They need to acknowledge more openly the limitations and uncertainties, and I think publishers like Times Higher go some way towards this, but not as far as I would like to see, in acknowledging the uncertainties in the measure. You will notice there were no confidence intervals or error bars associated with the numbers that they ascribe to individual universities. So is Caltech, for example, really significantly better in terms of score than the second placed institution on that list? Nobody can give me a good answer to that question. And we need access to the data. I think transparency is very important. If people are going to be judged using numbers, then they have to be able to test that data for themselves. So that we did touch on gender issues. I can't say that it was front and center of the discussion the whole time, but it certainly was a central topic for one of the workshops that we ran as part of the investigation into the use of metrics. So it's an area that I think needs more work, and I'm hoping to learn a lot more about it simply by attending this summit. But any system that's based on total citation numbers is, of course, going to favor more established researchers, and I sort of noted with approval the proposal from the State Secretary about capping the number of publications that people would be allowed to submit when applying for grants or promotions. I think that's an effective way to establish a fairer playing field between people who have obviously different circumstances, different family backgrounds, for example. We always, always, always need to humanize the metrics. You know, this is part of putting the numbers in context. Again, and I come back to this idea, numbers are terribly seductive. They're a great shortcut for judgment, and if we sort of give them any credibility, then we simply lean on them really rather too heavily, and we always have to be reminding ourselves what they really mean and what their limitations are, particularly because they have got the potential to change systemic and researcher behaviors. And we know, and I hear this increasingly, I have to say, over the past 5 or 10 years from PhD students and postdocs in my lab, their concern about the way the obsession with metrics is basically going to be a make or break decision for their careers. If they're not getting the right numbers, if they're not getting the citations or the papers in the right journals, then they kind of feel that, you know, it's hopeless for them, and they may very well join the cohorts who are exiting the science. So I wanted to touch finally, this is my last slide, just on some sort of personal reflections. Again, I reiterate, I'm an amateur in this space, but it's an issue that is increasingly coming to the fore. Certainly at Imperial College, it's discussed more and more. And there are programs in place in order to try and address some of the systemic issues. But I'm active on social media, and on social media, this sort of issue crops up from time to time. Some of you will be aware of recent initiatives, sometimes done with the best intentions. So the EDF, Energie de France, had a pretty curious initiative, which was the title of a program to try and encourage more women to get into technical and engineering fields. But the idea that perhaps those women then also had to be pretty in order to do that was problematic and seen as problematic in some. And similarly with the EU science, it's a girl thing, had an absolutely horrendous video which was very rightly dismantled in a quite a good-humoured way on the internet. Tim Hunt, God bless him, is infamous now, unfortunately, for ill-judged jokes that he made at a conference in Korea earlier this year. This is a quotation from his wife, Mary Collins. It was an unbelievably stupid thing to say. I think we can all agree with that. But you can see why it would be taken as offensive if you didn't know Tim. And again, it is about context. He did get crucified on the internet. He was criticized rightly. Crucifixion probably not quite justified. But that's one of the difficulties with our internet age and with the sort of rough and tumble of social media. It can be very difficult. A female journalist that I follow on Twitter yesterday wondered, you know, how many women's voices have been silenced because there's still a very angry backlash from some quarters, Louise managed to mention one, against anybody who is seen to be criticizing what Tim Hunt said, or, you know, there's a big argument about misreporting and who said what. And it's rumbling on and on, even now, sort of 5 or 6 months after the event. And that's a worrying development. I also think it's been disastrous, I think, for other men actually wanting to get into the space and sort of speak up on these issues, because it's a very aggressive and unpleasant place to be at times, particularly so, I think, for women. Troubles with perceptions. So Georgina Ferry wrote an interesting, it was actually about women in crystallography, which I read because I'm a crystallographer myself. It's my particular area of science. But she made this interesting observation. 14% of crystallographers were women. And to some observers, men, I would imagine, the field appeared to be saturated with women. They may be relieved to know that the number has now dropped back down to a healthy 10%. That's a joke, okay? That's a joke. And just finally then, a comment, and again, it sort of it links it to what I think the State Secretary had to say, is that, you know, men certainly have to be part of this discussion. And I think there are still many of us who don't necessarily see that there is a problem, who think that the numbers fall where they may, and that that is the natural order of things. And I think we have to be very mindful of active in pursuing the evidence and active in making the case that this is an important issue, and it isn't just an issue for women to solve. Men very much have to speak up too. So thank you very much for your attention.
Thanks so much, Stephen. That was wonderful. Let's take a few minutes here for some immediate reactions, questions, and comments to Stephen Curry's talk. I see one here and one there. We'll start with those two.
Thank you. Is that on? Yes. Thank you very much. That was very interesting. So, Verity Brown from the University of St. Andrews. You mentioned the fact that gender issues weren't central to the HEFC review. Do you think that might have been different if more than 3 of the 13 member panels had been women?
Yes.
Well, a man of few words, yes.
Jackie Hunter, you've raised the infamous Tim Hunt words. One of the things that showed me, and I'd be interested in your views on, is that sexism is seen as much less of an issue in general. If Tim Hunt had said black people cry more or gay people cry more, nobody would have stood by him. But because it happened to be sexism and he was slightly older, it was somehow okay. I'd be interested in your comments.
I think your observation is correct. I think the issue doesn't light fires in many minds in the way that racism, for example, would. And I think that's unfortunate. And part of the, I think, the defensive reaction on his behalf reflects, you know, that particular aspect of our culture, which is unfortunate. And that, I think, is why, you know, it needs to be challenged, hopefully politely, but actually that's a very difficult standard of behavior to achieve, certainly on Twitter or in social media. But unfortunately, it did get extremely heated extremely quickly, and we do need to find better ways to conduct that dialogue. But it definitely needs to be challenged. I think it has stirred it up. It certainly brought attention to it. But I think it has brought an awful lot of damage in its wake. And I'm not sure that there are easy solutions for that, except to, you know, encourage people to have the courage and hopefully the support to speak out about it.
Okay, we take one here and one here.
Thank you. Thank you for your wonderful presentation. My name is Simone Buitendijk. I'm the Vice Rector for Teaching and Learning at Leiden University, and I'm also working with PhD students and early career scholars. I think it's wonderful that you're pointing out how men basically aren't involved in this whole discussion. I always say men have a gender too. I'm not sure I coined that, but I think it's a very important phrase. Just this morning when I came in, I was a bit late. I was speaking to two nice young men downstairs who were hanging up coats, and I asked them why they weren't here listening to all the wonderful things. And they actually said, oh, gender is in our curriculum, but we don't think it's for us. One was an industrial ecologist and the other one in geography. I think it's very, very important that we get young men to understand that they too have so much to gain, because we're losing as an academia lots of young men to academics because they don't like the way the metrics work. They don't like the way the career paths are being structured. It's very macho, male, monodisciplinary, as if people don't have a life. So basically what I want to say is I would love to encourage you to try and speak up more for men and get fellow men involved, because it's very important for us as women that we're not seen as always trying to further our own cause. I find it easier at my university to speak up on behalf of LGBT students or minority cultural students than I find it to speak up for women. So we need men, and I would love to use this gender summit to make sure that the men who have seen the light, such as yourself, will be at the core of this, of a new movement. So is there a way? What ideas do you have? How are you going to persuade your male colleagues at Imperial, your vice chancellor, others to take this super seriously for humanity and society, not just for women?
Well, thank you for that comment. I agree with that. The first thing I would say is that I'm named after St. Stephen, who was the first martyr, and not St. Paul, who had the Damascene conversion. So I hope I'm not going to be a martyr to the cause. But
you'll be a saint, but not a martyr.
But only in my mother's eyes. But I agree. I mean, the issue of metrics and the sort of performance pressures that people are put under, and the fact that it, you know, science and research generally for men and women is becoming a bit of a treadmill, is a big issue. And I think some of the articles that I sort of pointed to at the very opening of my talk do reflect that. I know that I think it's an agenda that's on the rise. So the DORA logo that I had up was the Declaration on Research Assessment, and that is part of a move in order to try and ensure that the procedures that we go through to assess researchers are fair and meaningful and are not over-reliant on simple-minded metrics such as impact factors. And I'm pleased that certainly at my university now we are actually undergoing or conducting a review of performance metrics, and we're trying to look to see, you know, how should we be using them responsibly. It's informed, I'm on that committee myself now, so it's informed very much by the metrics review that we've conducted. It is a fairly male-dominated committee, I have to say, but that's partly the nature of Imperial College, which is a very science and technology-heavy university. But there is a widening understanding, I think, and hopefully it will come out in our report, that it's one has to take into account when assessing academics all the different things that they do. You know, good research, doing good research is very important. You know, we all want that for a better world. But also doing good teaching is important. And being a good mentor to young PhD students and postdocs, that's an important thing to value. And also being a good departmental citizen, you know, sitting on some of the boring committees and, you know, standing up when you want to be head of, or, you know, when they're looking for next head of department or director of undergraduate studies or whatever. And all of those things we have to recognize. For too long, it's simply been, you know, papers and grants are the thing that you get judged on. And we need to recognize that, you know, there are many other valuable aspects to academic life that have to be valued. So I think we're moving in the right direction, but there, it's a hard road.
So I understand you're volunteering to be a member of the good guy club that will be starting in Berlin these 2 days. Yes? Is that a yes? Great, thank you.
Thank you.
I promised one more. We take one more quick question and then we'll take the others at the end.
Hello. Hi. My name is Yudi Achibong, Professor of Diversity at the University of Bradford, and leading one of the Genovate project, a structural project funded by the European Commission. Just going back to your response to the first question about underrepresentation of women in the review board for the metrics work linked to the research excellence framework. It's good that you've acknowledged the underrepresentation. My question is, how are you going to take this knowledge forward? If I was doing a piece of research and I identified a flaw, people will critique that, and I will be looking at, or others will be looking at, how they might address that, bearing in mind that your work has huge implication for the next phase of the research excellence framework. What's going to happen? How have we published the fact that the underrepresentation of women in that board may have produced some flaws in their recommendations and so on? So how are you taking things forward from here rather than just acknowledging the absence?
Well, I certainly take the point, but I mean, we started out our work. I wasn't responsible for the inviting people onto the committee. I think it's something that certainly can be acknowledged. The fact that gender and diversity was an issue that was certainly considered as a part, so there is a section on those particular issues within the body of report, and I think the conclusions from that there are issues that need to be addressed and certainly explored in more detail, is one of the things that needs to be taken forward, so that in any future similar committee, then the composition and the bringing together of that committee will be informed by those particular considerations. So I hope that it would sort of move things in that direction, but the committee was the committee, and you know, I was unaware of the full composition of it when I joined.
Thanks so much, Stephen. Thank you very much. I see that there are many more hands out there. There are many more hands out there, and there, as there were after our first presentation also. Please note for yourself or write on Twitter your comment, and after our third talk, we'll have a little bit of time, and not only to address that third talk, but to make more general comments about all of them. Our final speaker in this session this morning is Professor Jacques Mairesse from Maastricht University in the Netherlands, who will be speaking about, does gender affect scientific productivity?
Okay, I'm very happy to be here, and I'm very happy also to speak after Steve Curry. I must state from the start that I agree fully with all what he says. So please don't make remarks on what I present based on what he says. Because I will use bibliometrics in order to answer the question that, does gender affect scientific productivity? This is the way. And basically, I will try to present three papers. The first one is a longer one. It has been published. And I think this is the reason of this paper why I'm here. And I must thank Elisabeth Politzer to invite me. And I will present it longer. I will have little time to present it. Usually it takes me 1-2 hours if I want to go into the details. So I ask also the chairman to tell me after 10 minutes where I am, because I'm extremely bad at timing, okay? Then I will present another work which is in revision, which is quite interesting, and I will present it very quickly. And then I will say a word about work in progress, which will be only 2 transparencies. So let me go down to the first one. The first one is published, you can read it. It's a work with Michele Pezzoni, on which we have worked a long time. And of course, most of you know about the productivity puzzle in science, and it says basically that publication productivity of female scientists is found to be lower than male publication productivity in almost all scientific fields, and I could add with most indicators. And so we started by doing a paper which was not focusing on this issue. It was focusing more on, can we use bibliometrics to understand better the process of production in science? But one of our results was striking, and is the one which corresponds to gender. So that's why we focus on the gender problem, on the gender issue, or gender gap, or gender bias. So we started by reading the literature, which is quite big, in fact. And we were surprised that although there is a lot of literature by sociologists, education people, and less by economists, but still, that there was no really evidence in the likely underlying causes. There is a lot of work, but evidence in the stem of statistical work was not so abundant, in fact. And surprisingly, the literature we try to do that, the puzzle remains. I can take the example of motherhood. I'm used to look that. I have to look here. And you know, the fact that motherhood or family engagement by women may be one of the reasons why their publication productivity will be less, at least when they are young, or one of the reasons why they go out, perhaps, of the earth of academia. There is not much really, strong evidence. In fact, when you look at the evidence, it sometimes goes both ways. It's not clear. And here I put, I put 2 references which are interesting. One is by Edie Prozesky. She did a thesis on this issue, and this is a paper out of her thesis. And she writes, something which I think it's nice, a certain measure of incompatibility exists between being a mother and a productive academic researcher. And I put down another one, which is by, that you can read, and which says that this statement is really an empirically untenable stereotype, or the motherhood myth, and it's even argued that the myth itself is a result of the fact that there is a gender gap between female and male. And then I cite also this, but I think this has been cited by Steve Curry, I think everyone knows that about Tim Hunt, but you may not know about the article which is in the New York Times, June 18. It's by someone, a young woman who is in a lab, and she says, what is it like as a girl in the lab? An article, in fact, raised a lot of, roar, because she made the point that, when you are a young girl, modern young girl, you can very well cope with sexist remarks because you don't care. And what matters is to be and to choose a very good advisor. So if you want to do a career, the best concern is to be with a very good advisor, with a man and woman, in a very good lab and on a very good topic. So that was also considered not very politically correct. So there was a lot of, if you read the comments, a lot of romance of that. But let me go to this present analysis. So what we try to do is first to observe the gender gap, but also to measure something that we can call the counterfactual or unbiased gender productivity gap that ideally would control for all factors affecting differently female and male scientists, and of course, in practice, the main important factors. We have seen by listening to Martina Schraudner that there is a lot of factors which can intervene to explain, you know, in our analysis, a case study, that there are a lot of factors which can matter. But in practice, if you want to do statistics, you need to focus on some important factors. And what we do, this is in red, this is our conclusion. We show that, however, that although there is female science, physicist appears, so we work here on French CNRS, which is a big institution in France, non-university, and in university physicists. And basically, we cover, I would say, 90% of the physicists in France, and we exclude nuclear and particle physicists, where they have publication with many, many courses, many of them, to the point that some people said that the idea of the individual course disappears. There is no individual courses. You know, they write 5 pages with 100 courses. You don't know who is. There is a leader of the group, but there is no real authors. So we were told from the beginning that we should not consider them. So we observe in both cases that the productive woman in terms of publication is about one third less than the one of men. And when we do our kinetic analysis and when we take care of several factors, but mainly the unequal chance of promotion, given their past history of publication, given their age, and when we take care also the fact that they have more frequent non-publishing spell, that is time in their life, when they don't publish, nothing, that and this statistic of non-publishing scale can reflect strong family engagements. Also, we have no direct evidence for that. Then this will account for the difference we see. In fact, in the end, we find that in CNRS, women will be counterfactual, you know, will be as productive as men, and in universities, they will be even more productive. So this is what I will try to present with no numbers, just with pictures. But still, I have to tell you how we measure. I agree. I mean, this is a measure or an indicator. I should say indicator. I agree. I mean, there is. So what we use is productivity measured as a sum of impact factors. So basically, it's a number of publications weighted by the impact factors of the journal, 5 years impact factor of the journal where this publication are published. Now, if we didn't do the impact factor, we find basically the same result. What we look, it's only the journals which have an impact factor of more than 0.5, which means that over 5 years, at least in this journal, a paper, an average paper in this journal, will receive at least half a citation. We do the same analysis in the work with a threshold not of 0.5, but of 5, or even of 10, that is only looking at excellent journal with a high reputation, and basically, we find exactly the same results of our analysis. So look at some numbers here. I cannot point. Oh, yes, there is a pointer. So this is what we look, for example. Here you have two institutions. My God, it doesn't look very well. I'm on side, that's why. I should be here. You see women CNRS, men CNRS. Basically, there is two institutions. We don't compare the two institutions. When you look at the numbers, you will see that CNRS, in terms of these numbers, are more productive. But we don't compare them. We just compare male and female within CNRS, male and female physicists within universities. Because, as Steve said, the context is very important. And so we don't want to mix them because the context of when they do research is very different. As you know, in CNRS, I suppose you know, the researchers, the scientists are supposed to do full-time research. In universities, they're supposed to spend only half of their time doing research and the other half doing teaching. So we didn't want to compare that because that we cannot measure, and I don't think it makes sense. There is also more selection at the entrance of CNRS than at universities. So the difference, sorry, I should go back. You see the difference, for example, I want comment all the numbers, but for example, between women university and men university, men are twice more productive, 2.06, than female. Which means that the median, if you look at the median, the median publication, the median statistic, is zero. Now, if you don't take into account, if you don't take into account the publication, the year of publication where they don't publish, in fact, we do a panel we look at 3 years, triplets. We don't look at the statistic for 1 year, but for 3 years. We have a long enough panel so that we can take as a period of observation 3 years. So if you look at this panel, you see that when you don't take into account the non-publishing sphere, basically the difference between men and women at university is only 25%. Okay, so we go from two. Okay, I'm really going very little. So here is the observation. You see, this is the log predict. We work in logs, but it's equivalent. So logs, you cannot compute, you see, the zero. So we abstract of the non-publishing spells when we look at that. And you have in red and in blue the continuous line. You have CNRS women, CNRS men. And the dotted line, you have university women and university men. And you see the difference between those two curves. It shows the gap, you see, those two ones. It's a gap between male and female in both type of institution. And you see that it goes down a little with, publication goes down a little with age. Let me go faster. One important point is that the gender gap we have measured is an average. Oh, sorry. I should stay with this? Oh, sorry. I'm used to it. I will not move. An important point is that the gender gap is, as I documented it, is an average gap. Okay? If you look at dispersion, you see, for example, these are the curves. You see this is normal, in fact. This is log normal, or more or less log normal. In fact, you see that in CNRS, for example, 45% of the women are more productive than the average CNRS man. And the same number for university is 42. So remember those two graphs, the preceding one and this one. I will show them after. The strategy is to explain productivity by gender, J, A, age, IC, initial conditions. I don't explain probability of rank, and lambda. Probability of rank is the rank you have, the two ranks we are considering in these two institutions is basically professor or maître de conférence, let's say professor and assistant, and the similar grades for CNRS, which is chargé de recherche et directeur de recherche. But now, this variable in terms of econometrics, is endogenous. That is, if you don't take into account that it's more easy to be promoted professor when you are male relative to a woman, then the evidence that you will have if you estimate the first equation will be wrong. There will be a bias. So we want to correct for this bias. And in order to do that, we have to have an equation which explains promotion and takes that into consideration. And the third one is an equation which explains what we find for the fact that there is more non-publishing spell for women than for female. If that was at random, pure randomness, this last equation would explain nothing. If it's really correlated with publication and with the gender, there will be some meaning, and the meaning, of course, could be one of the factors, which is motherhood, family engagement, could be other factors, could be motivation, could be, cultural traits. I'm not so interested than men in publishing for other reasons. These are the other variables. I will go very quickly. We have a lot of variables about collaboration. For example, there is one which is interesting, which is the number of courses. I have no time to talk about that. But there is also, exploratory variables. So let me go back to this. This is the observation you have seen. When we take into account the promotion and the publishing spells, and we do things right, this is what we find. You see that now there is basically no difference between the non-dotted line, which are the continuous line, which is CNRS, and you see that now the dotted line in red is above the blue one, showing that women, in fact, are more when they go over the age of 35, near 40, they tend to be more productive. And if you look at this dispersion, you see now that the two curves for, you see, this is the one which has observed, and now you have seen it. Now I go to the one in predicted. You see that CNRS, the two curves are really, you don't see the difference. And you see basically that the one for university are the same, but it still corresponds to a little more productive female than men. Okay, this is the result. Let me go to the other one. I have 2 minutes. 2 minutes. So it will be difficult. So this is another work that we do for an elite university. Oh my God. I should look there, you know. Sorry, I should look at you and I should look at here. So we focus on PhD student productivity because we saw that for two reasons, or for three reasons. First, because we saw that when they are PhD students, you see they tend not to be married, they are still very young. We do that for an elite university. We are not supposed to say which elite university, but after listening to Steve Curry and saying the ranking, you can look at the top and you know which one it is. Okay, and so in elite university, we know that people are selected in a very strong way, you know, so the difference there, you know, you should have the same aptitude. So we know also, so what we know here also that, you know, in this university, in other universities, basically PhD students are also essential to the publication process. All the publication of these people, the faculty in this university, basically 95% of the publication, they have a PhD student or two PhD students as courses. And we know, not only consider gender of the advisor, but that of the advisor advisee gender pairing, and even the gender composition of the team. Let me just go next. This is, you know, there is not very many faculty in this university at a given point of time, 300. But we have a sample of 1993 PhDs and a sample of observation 5,000. And these are the results, which are interesting. So if you look here, we have all discipline on the left side, the more to the left, you see the difference. So the comparison, the reference is male student, male advisor. So if you look, for example, at the light blue, 10%, it tells you that a male student having a female advisor published 10% more than a male student with a male advisor. You can see that female student with a male advisor does 8% less publication than a male student with a male advisor. So you see, this is very striking. This is not as well, this is true not only on the first is all discipline pub. Pub means number of publication. When you go to the next one, it's IF, it's impact factor, average impact factor. It's not only based on the number of publication, but it's also true for the quality of the journal in which they publish. The same evidence, you see? Minus 11 for a female with a male advisor, and plus 27 average impact factor for a male student with a female advisor. So, okay, I'm done. These are the conclusions in numbers. This is a poster. I advise a poster. It's with Lorena Rivera Leon. Her poster is number 25. It's very, very good. She's trying to do the same analysis that we have done for France, CNRS, and universities in South Africa, where we have male and female, but we've also the white community and the non-white. And so we are trying to do the same. Thank you. Sorry for being long.
So we have a little bit of time for discussion here, and I just need to ask the organizers, is there a quiz before we are breaking, or do I have all of the time until the break? I have 10 minutes. Okay, so let's take a couple of minutes about our last talk, and then we'll take a few minutes about the bigger picture. Why don't you wait here for a couple of minutes? Let's start here, and then we'll take one back there.
Thank you.
Just talk. It will magically just talk.
Thank you. Can you hear me?
Somebody turn on that microphone.
Is it work? Yes. Thank you very much for excellent presentations. Professor Noriti Yirmiya, Chief Scientist at the Ministry of Science, Technology and Space from Israel and the Chairperson of the National Committee for the Advancement of Women in Science and Technology. Very happy to be here. And just thinking about the three presentations and especially your last few slides, actually the question that comes to my mind is it the fact that actually unconscious bias is something that both men and women share, and that actually when we think about the change that we all need to work toward, it's the fact that we know that women and men allow now more and more women to come out from the private part of life, from the family, to the career, to the public. But vice versa is not as welcomed nor rewarded. And whether that is where we need to work as a society, that is our challenge, to allow each person, regardless of their gender, to be who they wish to be in the private and the public sector. So we need, as State Secretary stated, both men and women working together so that we all can actualize our potential and be who we wish to be.
Well, I will try. It's difficult. Let me try two points very quickly. One, if you take the word, I'm not answering now exactly, if you take what we find, we say that really our goal that will be that, you know, equality of gender. One very important thing is that promotion should be non-discriminatory. That's very important, and it plays a big role in what we do. Now, if I want to answer your question, there is a big debate, you know, about theories. There is a book by Gerhard Sonnert about the gender dimension in science. And basically, it takes two extreme positions. One is what he calls the difference model, and the other is the deficit model. The difference model, he says, well, assume that women and men have the same goals. They really want to do the same thing. And then, you know, you can see, now this is what he called, this is called the difference. The other extreme is they have not the difference, they have not the same goals, and then they, in the first one, you know, if they don't succeed the same, it's because there is discrimination, there is obstacles which are different for men and women. In the other extreme, it is because they have different goals, and then they try to do different things. In fact, in what we do here, and it's evidence really, it's much more mixed than what the one you say. I mean, basically, the two are mixed. You know, it could be that there is a mix of different goals and there is a mix, you know, of discrimination. So it's in what you say, I mean, you assume in a sense that they have the same goals. I'm not sure this is,
no,
they have the same goals.
No.
Yes, that's right. Which allows that? Okay.
Great. And let's see, I think there was a hand right back here.
Rolf Tarek, European University Association. Since some of your results are interesting and striking, particularly the last one, striking, where you show that the difference between having a male supervisor and a female student and vice versa are huge. Why didn't you put at least the statistical error bars? So that we know that your results are significant.
We look at that. They are significant. Perhaps not for physics, because the sample is small, but the other one are.
So these differences...
For disciplines.
These differences that you have 10% more and the other one 9% less,
I will use a confidence interval.
Okay, good, thanks.
But I didn't present it here.
Yep.
Okay, thank you.
All right, we have a few minutes left. And I want to open the floor not only to comments about the last talk, but that's of course welcome, but also about the first talk. And I'm very aware that I took more questions after the second talk than after the first talk, and I'm troubled by that. So I want to encourage questions for the first talk also. But anyway, there are many hands here, and I want to I see 1, 2, 3, and let's take a few comments, and then we'll see if the speakers want to comment on them. Can we start here with Gerlind?
Thank you. My name is Gerlind Ballum from EMBO, and my question is actually to Jacques. You showed in your data that there was this productivity gap, in particular in the years between 30 and 40. So you did not explain, and I don't know whether you explored this, whether this then has to do with the motherhood gap or motherhood penalty that you mentioned before. Did you look at that? So why was there this publication gap at the beginning, which you then had to correct for?
I think that what we need to do now is to hear some of the questions so that we know the kinds of things that people are thinking about, and even if we don't get them all answered, we know that we have things to tweet about. Yes, here.
Once again, Christel Baltes-Löhr from the University of Luxembourg. Thank you very much. I would raise two questions. First is the quality. We have now heard a lot of data or numbers of how many articles are published by men or women. But the quality is related to the quality of the journal, but not to the quality of the article. And my question is the following. Can we have an idea of if perhaps the so-called men are publishing otherwise as so-called female are doing? The quality not of the journal, but the quality of what is published. I have the impression that men are more easier doing a publication than female scientists are doing. So second question or second remark or comment. We have now heard a little bit about female and male persons, and I would like to underline, and perhaps this Gender Summit 8 will respect it a little bit also systematic, that we have a world where we have transgender and intersex person also, and when we are speaking about all, we have perhaps all not to forget and not to put them in a footnote, the persons who are also in the reality, and they are not so few. Thank you very much.
Okay, I'm going to take two very brief comments, one here, and then I'm sorry.
Connie Arts, I'm a physicist, and I would like to challenge the requirement of mobility. I don't care where people live when they do their work. I want to know if they are internationally recognized, and you can measure that by invited review talks, by presence in international panels, international community, but not where they live. Some also have the comfort of private, high competitive grants. Please let scientists organize their family life themselves. That's not what you want to measure.
Thank you. One more.
Well, I'm an engineer, and I would have liked to listen to some more evidence regarding female involved in engineering science rather than science only. Thank you.
Thank you so much. I know there were many hands out there, some of them even wrapped around microphones, and I apologize for not getting to all of you, but I'm under massive pressure from the organizers here to wrap it up. This session has, I think, been a terrific opportunity to think about what it means not only to encounter bias and see different career paths for men and women, but also to think about the relationship between that and the kinds of attempts that we make to measure quality. Thanks so much for three very stimulating talks and for your observations and questions.